My guest today is Jack Goldsmith. So first, by way of introduction, Jack is the current Henry L. Shattuck Professor of Law at Harvard Law School. He was in the George W. Bush administration, so that's Bush II, and he was head of the Office of Legal Counsel, and he achieved some fame there by opposing the enhanced interrogation techniques and warrantless surveillance of that era. So thank you, Jack, and thank you for being here.
Thank you very much for having me.
So we're here to talk about Jack's most recent book. It's called In Hoffa's Shadow. And so this story is really about Jimmy Hoffa, Chuckie O'Brien, and really a father-son story. And so, Jack, that's really where I want to start the story, which is, I think it was June of 1975, and your mom marries Chuckie O'Brien. So you want to take us through the relationship?
So I was 12 years old. My mom had been married twice before. She had met Chuckie about 5 months before. They fell in love, and they were married in June of 1975, which was about 6 weeks before Hoffa disappeared. And Chuckie was the first really great father I'd ever had, first father I'd ever had. My other two fathers weren't great. And so I immediately became very close to him in the 3 or 4 months before the marriage that in June of 75.
So 6 weeks later, the world explodes.
Yes. So it was for both Chuckie and my mom, this was kind of this, they were both in a bad place in their lives. They just got married. They were just on top of the world. We were moving to Florida. The world looked very optimistic to them, and then Jimmy Hoffa disappears. And there are younger people in the audience. It's impossible to exaggerate what a huge story this was. It was because Hoffa was so famous and because he disappeared without a trace, because they were just couldn't find out anything about what happened to him. So it was front page news for a very long time, and Chuckie soon became the leading suspect. So that all of that investigation force came down in our family.
Now, Chuckie was not a made guy in the mob, but he was well-connected.
Correct. So Chuckie was half Irish and half Sicilian, and that means he couldn't be a made man in the mob, but his mother came from a Sicilian family, and by Sicilian family, I mean a Sicilian organized crime family in Kansas City. So Chuckie grew up in that world in Kansas City, and then when he moved to Detroit with his mom, she became very close to the mob in Detroit. Chuckie became very close to them, and his other father figure besides Jimmy Hoffa was a Detroit mobster named Anthony Giacalone, who turned out also to be the leading suspect in the disappearance. So Chuckie was very close to the mob. He was very close to Hoffa. He negotiated that relationship his whole life, and then when Hoffa disappears, he was right in the middle of it between his two father figures, in effect.
Now, you're in high school, and you obviously developed a close relationship with Chuckie during that period, but all these people were circulating in his life and there in your life. What was that like? Uncle Tony?
So I had Sally two Bugs. Uncles, Uncle Tony Giacalone and Uncle Tony Provenzano, yeah. Tony Pro Provenzano. These were two notoriously violent, tough guy mobsters. I didn't learn that until later. I read about it in the newspaper, but in my experience, these were my new family. They were upright gentlemen. They were very kind and sweet. They were well-dressed. They were very kind to my family. So I really thought they were the greatest when I was in high school.
But as I said, from my perspective, the book is really a father-son story. And so you had a period of time when you admired Chuckie. You actually took his name. You were Jack O'Brien, I think.
From age 13 until 21.
Right. And then you had an estrangement and then a reconciliation.
Right. So the estrangement came. So I went, when I left high school and went to Washington and Lee University for college, my relationship with Chuckie was at its height. When I got to college, a whole bunch of things started happening. One, I started reading books about the Hoffa disappearance, and it turns out that my uncles Tony and Tony were really violent, bad guys, and it turned out also that despite what my stepfather had told me, that the mafia really does exist and is very violent, it turns out that my stepfather had a criminal past. I learned a lot of things I didn't know about, and it kind of scared me. And also, I used to revel in Chuckie's union identity, the jeans and the Teamsters jacket and the rough language. And when I got to college, I developed a different attitude towards that. I became more interested in ideas, which is something he wasn't interested in. One day, a very large repo man came to my house and repossessed my car that Chucky had given me, and it was a frightening experience. So I started to rethink Chucky in college, and I also finally started thinking about my career. I was accepted to Yale Law School, and I started thinking about having a career in the law with my stepfather as the leading suspect in the Hoffa disappearance and my association with all these mobsters. So basically, I started cutting Chucky out of my life. The first step was to change my name after graduation. That was very painful for him. We had an exchange of letters, which I reproduce in the book, which is kind of painful for me to read now. But at the time, I felt very confident I was doing the right thing. And then when I got to law school and I thought about it more, by the time I got to law school, I basically just cut him out of my life. I had convinced myself that he was a bad guy and that I wanted to have my life. And so I just blew him off, not to put too fine a point on it.
Mm-hmm. And how did you reconcile with him?
So for 20 years, I didn't speak to him. For 20 years, I wouldn't visit my mom when he was there. And it's not something I admire now. I talk about this in the book. So the process of reconciliation began when I was in the Justice Department. I had a position in the Justice Department as the head of the Office of Legal Counsel, which is basically the president's lawyer through the Attorney General, and the office that makes judgments for the executive branch about what the law requires. This is the office that issued the famous torture memos and the warrantless wiretapping memos that you probably read about. And I was the one who was involved in trying to fix those programs and reverse some of those opinions and put them on a better legal footing. In the course of working on the warrantless wiretapping program, Stellar Wind is what it's called, very highly classified at the time, I was reading opinions about the Fourth Amendment to the Constitution, which protects privacy from the government, and I came across two citations in a case I was reading. One was O'Brien versus United States, and the other was Hoffa versus United States, and these are not cases I'd read before. And I read them, and they turned out to be cases about the government engaged in illegal surveillance against Chucky and Hoffa back in the 60s. And this was kind of a revelation to me for a whole bunch of reasons. It taught me something I learned much more about later, which is that I was in the middle of a program that was legally very problematic, and that problematic government surveillance had been going on for decades. Two, Chucky had always told me when I was a kid how the government cut corners, he called it backup. When they would interpret the law in a way that was not really what the law said, in a way so that they could go after people. And I had this realization that my uneducated, non-legally trained stepfather who I had been so condescending to was right, and that I was kind of in the middle of it myself then too. So that was kind of a shock, and I wouldn't say that I changed my mind about Chucky right then, but that led me on a path of about a year long of reflection. I had my own children, which changed my attitude towards what I had done to Chucky. And so a lot of things sort of led me to think less of my own virtue and more of his. And one night after I had left the government, I went to visit him. This time I was kind to him for the first time in 20 years. He reciprocated. And one night I asked for his forgiveness just out of nowhere. And he looked at me with an ashen face, and his eyes were watering, and he said, "I forgive you, son, of course. I understand why you did what you did." And it was an extraordinary moment in my life. And he never talked to me about it again, and we became very close after that. Mm-hmm.
And when did you decide to take on this task, Jack, which is to rehabilitate his reputation, maybe actually exonerate him from any involvement in the Hoffa murder?
So after we reconciled, we spent a lot of time talking. We spent a ton of time together. We grew much closer than we'd ever been before. And over the course of those conversations, I wasn't thinking about writing a book, but we talked about Hoffa and the disappearance. And without doing a lot of research, I came to suspect that the claims against him didn't make sense to me. And I was sure that a lot of things said about him were wrong. So I said to him one day, "Why don't we write a book about this? I don't know where it'll go, but I'm 100% sure I'll give you a fair shake." One thing to emphasize, Chucky was tagged with responsibility for the disappearance in August of 1975. The FBI tagged him with that. They said he picked up Hoffa and drove him to his death. And that claim has been out in the public and believed in movie after movie and story after story for 44 years now, including most lately in The Irishman, played by Jesse Plemons. So I wanted to rebut that claim, which I came not to believe. And that's what I set out to do. The book turned out to be so much more. It got very complicated with the things I learned about all sorts of other things going on. But that was the essential impetus for the book.
So what I really enjoyed, among other things in the book, is the cat and mouse game he plays with you with his code of omerta, the Sicilian code of silence. And he probably knows who killed Hoffa, but...
I'm certainly sure he knows more than he told me. So Chucky is, as you said, half Sicilian, half Irish, but he's really Sicilian in his values. That's what he would say. And by that I mean that the kind of Sicilian organized crime norms are things that he's absorbed completely. And among other things, that means you're not supposed to talk about what you know, including to me. And I knew this was going to be a hurdle at the beginning of our conversations, and I was candid with him about it. He was candid with me about it. Over the course of 7 years, he told me a whole lot of stuff, including stuff he probably didn't mean to or probably shouldn't have. But he also didn't tell me a lot of stuff. And we had these back and forths where I'm, as a prosecutor, trying to probe, and he's kind of deflecting and changing the story. It was very frustrating for me. My assistant, who transcribed these hundreds of hours of tape, was always in stitches laughing because he was so good at deflecting my questions. So that was a constant presence, his commitment to, which for him, telling the truth was less important to this commitment that he not speak. And obviously, when you're trying to clear someone from alleged crime and he's your main witness, also to make this more challenging, is Chucky has a notorious reputation of being a pathological liar, which I experienced. It's not quite as bad as it sounds, but he often fibs, skews, says something that isn't true that he knows isn't true. So this is my main witness, a guy who's... He was committed to not telling me the truth and is known to be a pathological liar.
Yeah.
And so that was a very complicated set of negotiations.
Well, let's see if we can figure out who killed Hoffa. So let's lay the foundation. Let's lay the foundation here, Jack, for a second.
I predict we're not going to, but we might.
Okay. But let's lay the foundation for people that have forgotten or never knew how famous and how powerful and effective Jimmy Hoffa was during his heyday.
So we live in a world where private sector unions are very weak and in which there's not a lot of union solidarity in this country. In the 50s and 60s, when Hoffa was in his heyday, he was running the largest union in the country, the Teamsters Union. It was primarily truckers, but not just truckers, warehouse workers, and he actually organized anyone. But it was primarily at its core a union about truckers. And Hoffa had complete control over the truckers, which means he had control over the national economy. He was in a very powerful position. He was brilliant at what he did. There is the corrupt side of Hoffa, but there's also the labor leader side of Hoffa. And he was an absolute genius, and that's not a term I use. That's a term used by labor historians. At using the power over transportation to leverage it into better wages and working conditions for these workers. And he was very successful at bringing many hundreds of thousands of people into the middle class and have much better working conditions for them. So he was a very important, the most important and most famous labor leader at a time when unions were very consequential forces in American society. It was a very different world.
And what you describe so well in the book are two aspects of his career. One is Bobby Kennedy's vendetta against him, and then the government use of, as Chucky's phrase, backup in terms of surveilling him.
Right.
So start with the Kennedy vendetta.
So there's a famous feud between Bobby Kennedy, when he was a very young man, and Jimmy Hoffa, and it played out in two stages. Kennedy was the head of something called the McClellan Committee, which was a congressional investigation in the late 1950s, and he was the lead investigator. And his main antagonist was Jimmy Hoffa. And he really went after Hoffa with everything he could to try to paint him as corrupt and not looking out for the workers and the like. Kennedy was a hothead, and he wasn't a great lawyer, and he didn't marshal the evidence very well, but he was very good at insinuating guilt, and he brought some tough charges against Hoffa. That went on for 3 years, and it resulted with Hoffa basically getting off scot-free. And that was a famous moment in American history. That was only Act One. Act Two was when John F. Kennedy won the presidency and became president in 61, and quickly chose his brother as Attorney General of the United States. It was such an important thing for the Kennedys to put Hoffa away. The famous Nixon-Kennedy debate, the one with Nixon's 5 o'clock shadow, John F. Kennedy opened his speech talking about what he was going to do as president, and the second thing he mentioned was putting Jimmy Hoffa away. And so Bobby Kennedy becomes Attorney General, and he basically gets the best and the brightest in the Justice Department to use every resource it can to put Hoffa in jail. And he succeeded ultimately. This is a case, it's the paradigm case in American history of what's thought of as prosecutorial excess. He went after Nick Hoffa for some smallish things, but he threw every resource he had at it, and some legal, some not. At the same time, his Justice Department was, and the FBI was engaging in rampantly illegal surveillance, not necessarily of Hoffa, but of Chucky and Jack Loney and Chucky's mom. So Kennedy cut a lot of corners. He finally put Hoffa away. Now, Hoffa, on the other side of things, Hoffa was no angel. Hoffa committed crimes all the time, including in these trials. He was a briber. He bribed juries. He liked to bribe juries. It was his way of defeating criminal charges. And that's what Kennedy ultimately got him on, was bribing a juror. Now, the second thing, back up. And this is something that I started to realize when I was in the Justice Department. Chucky had this phrase, backup. Chucky's not a lawyer, doesn't really understand the law, but his phrase, backup, is when the government can go after you and be very aggressive and cut lots of legal corners in secret because they get to interpret the law they're enforcing, and a lot of people don't know what they're doing in secret, and so they can violate the laws when they're going after you for violating the laws. And he called that backup. And it turns out that there was a ton of backup going on during the Kennedy administration, especially with regard to illegal surveillance. This was a time when they were trying to get up to speed on what the mob was doing. They were planting bugs in rooms and getting tons of information, clearly illegal under Supreme Court precedent. It was all very quiet. And they were doing so based on interpretations of the law that were laughable, but they were all taking place in secret, and so nobody knew.
So one of the ironies that you point out is that the corrupt process of Hoffa was taking the Teamsters pension fund and then making inside loans and deals with the mob and the real estate dealings and everything. But he was disciplined about it, risk managed,
yes,
and everything else.
He was actually very disciplined. And as Chucky said, if I could interrupt, as Chucky said, Hoffa often said no. That these mob guys came to Chucky for these loans, as Chucky put it, those white-shirted, stiff-assed bankers wouldn't give them loans, so they had to
nobody
go to Hoffa.
Liked this.
Sorry, I wasn't pointing fingers, but so they couldn't get loans from the Goldman Sachs of the world, so they went to Jimmy Hoffa and he gave them loans, basically to build hotels and casinos, primarily in Las Vegas. And Hoffa ran a hard bargain. He required $50,000 upfront in his pocket just to be considered, and he often said no. He got upfront cash, 10% of the loan, and then he got a point on the loan. Yeah. All corrupt. I mean, this is all going, so he's loaning out the funds of the Teamsters Union and making a ton of money on the side. Now, to be fair, he was not using that money to buy expensive clothes and fancy places to stay and fancy travel. He was a workaholic, spent all his time working for the workers, and he used that money to exercise power for the workers. I'm not saying that justifies it, but he thought it was just fine because he didn't believe in the law anyway. He thought the government was corrupt, and he was using it for a good end.
Right, so ironically, the mob was happy to see him go away because Frank Fitzsimmons was a much easier touch.
Yes, this is very important. So when Hoffa goes to jail in 67 because Kennedy put him away, he's replaced by a man named Frank Fitzsimmons, and Fitzsimmons was very weak, and Fitzsimmons didn't like controversy. So Hoffa's in jail, and Fitzsimmons basically turns over the pension fund to the mob through an intermediary. So Hoffa, who used to have arm's length on these transactions, is gone, and the mob is gorging on Teamsters pension funds, and they're making a lot of money off of it, and on terms that were much more favorable to them. And this is the reason why Hoffa was in jail for 4 years. Hoffa gets out of jail. He wants to get control of the Teamsters Union back, but the mafia is not remotely interested in letting him get back. They like Fitzsimmons.
So let's fast forward to 1975. And so Hoffa's been out for a while. He's annoying a lot of people, some very important people like Uncle Tony. And that's not good. And what do you think happens?
So the story of what happens is that Jimmy Hoffa was supposed to have a meeting in a restaurant at 2:30 in the afternoon in a Detroit suburb. That's pretty clear. And that's where he was last seen. He was last seen in that restaurant, and the theory is, and we don't really have any evidence, is he was picked up and taken to his death. And the theory is that Chucky picked him up and took him to his death. Chucky was in that neighborhood, and there are lots of circumstantial evidence that points to Chucky and led the FBI to suspect him. It's just circumstantial evidence, but it points to Chucky. I show convincingly that Chucky was not there that day. I also point out, this is something that's not known, that the FBI for 25 years has not believed. They've changed their theory, but never bothered to tell anyone in public, so Chucky's still stuck with this, that about Chucky's being involved. And I think I tell a convincing story based in part on what I learned from the FBI and their current views of the case, that Chucky was not, in fact, involved in the disappearance. He wasn't there that day. But that raises the question, who was that day and who killed Jimmy Hoffa? And
is he buried in Giant Stadium?
Yes, that's the claim, is that he was, that's one of dozens of claims about where he's buried. There have been 13 digs around the country, mostly in Detroit, looking for his body over the last 40 years. One big rumor was Giant Stadium. So I can just say that I don't know what happened to Jimmy Hoffa. I don't believe we're ever going to know for sure. I can tell you this, that the current FBI, and I know this because I spent a lot of time with these guys, the current FBI believes that Chucky was not there. They believe it was two men. They believe this based on surveillance evidence and informant evidence, that it was two men who were, one was the brother of Uncle Tony. His name was Vito Giacalone. He was a very violent guy, and his whereabouts that day have never been known, and he was always a suspect, but they never had any idea where he was.
Is he still alive?
He's not. Yeah. None of these people are alive except Chucky. And so Vito Giacalone and another guy who I didn't name in the book and probably won't name, who was a low-level Detroit mob guy who quickly rose in prominence in the Detroit family, and he was allegedly the guy that killed him. That's what I know. Not a very dramatic story, just two guys. There's so many things, let me just say, that are mysterious about that afternoon. Mm-hmm. Hoffa shows up at 2 o'clock, thinking he's going to have a meeting in the afternoon there. He waits an hour and a half, and he's furious because he thought the meeting was at 2. The meeting was actually supposed to start at 2:30, but he waits till 3:30. Hoffa never waited for anything. Why did he wait so long, and what happened to the hitmen? Why were they so late? I don't know what happened that afternoon, but they think that Vito Giacalone and this other guy picked him up and killed him. And they also think, I believe, that he was not brought to Giant Stadium, which is very risky, that he was basically incinerated nearby.
So I think one thing you're certain of, too, is the Irishman was a complete work of fiction.
It was a complete work of fiction.
He's Irish and with Philadelphia. That was the
yeah. So there, you know, there actually was all there were people with those names: Frank Sheeran, Russell Buffalino, Jimmy Hoffa, Tony Provenzano, and at the 40,000 foot level, it was true. There was a mob conspiracy to kill Hoffa because he was trying to get the Teamsters back. But nothing about Sheeran's role in that is true. There's no evidence to support it. The circumstances of the confession are extremely doubtful, and there's a lot of evidence to suggest it's not true. And what the author there did, I believe, is to take the basic known story of the FBI theory from 75 and then work Sheeran into it. But as I've shown in some writings, there are a lot of fibs along the way and a lot of evidence that belies the claims that were made for Sheeran. And, you know, Scorsese has not defended the truth of the movie. He said, I don't really care about the truth, I'm telling a story. Mm-hmm. So. And the thing that was most bothersome to Chucky is that he's played by Jesse Plemons, driving Hoffa to his death, and Jesse Plemons comes off as an idiot, which Hoffa, right. Which Chucky also didn't like. But so that was a tough thing for him to take. He's been accused of this for 44 years. It's not true. The FBI hasn't believed it's true for 25 years. But he's now everybody thinks it's true.
Well, one interesting thing about the path and the timeline here, Jack, is that you see, it's in the 50s, 60s, and through the 70s, unions plus the mob were very powerful. 2020, unions and the mob.
Right. Yes, and these are all related phenomena. So one of the stories I tell in the book is that there are many reasons, and there's a lot of study on this, for the decline of labor. The high point of labor, the very high point of labor in terms of union density, percentage of workers who were in unions and union power, was literally the point at which Bobby Kennedy started going after Jimmy Hoffa. And during that year, of just really going after Hoffa for being corrupt. And Hoffa was corrupt, but Kennedy exaggerated it, and he painted all of labor with it. There was like a 10% drop that year. And there's been a precipitous decline ever since. And labor historians say that that was the moment at which labor got tagged with the corruption label. Sometimes true, sometimes false. And the decline of labor is also basically, it's been the government with laws and regulations and things like that, making it very hard for unions to succeed, plus terrible management on the union side. There's a lot of problems that have led to the decline of labor. At the same time, there's the decline of the mob. And the irony about the decline of the mob is that it really happened because of the Jimmy Hoffa disappearance. This is one of the great, so two great ironies maybe to end this part of the conversation. Bobby Kennedy was sure that if he decapitated Hoffa from the Teamsters, that that would end the mob's relationship with the Teamsters, because he assumed that they were just in bed together and that was the nature of the relationship. In fact, the opposite happened. When he decapitated Hoffa, Hoffa was holding the mob back, as we discussed earlier, and the mob came in and took over the Teamsters. That was one irony. The second irony was the mob killed Hoffa because they thought he was going to rat on them and their relations with the union and expose the whole deal. He didn't rat on them, but the execution, the murder of Jimmy Hoffa and the massive investigation afterwards opened the government's eyes to the extent to which the mob had infiltrated unions. And that was the point at which the government finally used the pretty prodigious tools that had, material witness and new surveillance techniques and the like.
And backup.
And backup. Lots of backup to be very aggressive about the mob. So there's a direct connection between the Hoffa disappearance, the government waking up to how bad the mob was, and then in the 70s and 80s, Rudy Giuliani led the charge, really going after the mob and dismantling it. Mm-hmm. So the decline of labor and the decline of the mob kind of go hand in hand, just as the rise did as well.
Yes. Well, Jack, thank you so much for
taking
your time
here. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Good luck.
Thank you. Very kind.